Sweet. Hi, Theo. You saw my head up there earlier. I allegedly learned Gleam in a week at a very high level. I'm here to give you an overview of the Gleam language because I think it's really neat, and sort of some of the neat features, some of the gnarly features coming from an Elixir background, and to give you my verdict on it, I guess. So let's roll. We're going to go through four sections in this talk. First of all, W2AF is Gleam. Just kind of a quick rundown of what Gleam is, how it's kind of situated in the ecosystem. We're going to look at some of Gleam's
Sorry, I'm not sure.
syntax. Sorry?
I'm not sure we can see the slides online.
Neat.
We're not sharing them, it would seem potentially. Oh yeah, that would be right. Let's actually like do this properly. Here we go. Apologies to online people. Yeah, I guess feel free to start again if you want
It's
to.
just, it's all good.
Yeah, all right.
Thank you for calling that out.
Yes, that was
Thanks,
appreciated.
Ben.
Cool. Is that, can I full screen this now?
Yes.
No? Yes?
Should be okay to.
That's fine.
Yeah.
Cool. All right. Here's an overview of what we're going to be talking about for the people that missed this online. We're going to have a quick overview of what Gleam is and how it's situated in the ecosystem with other languages. We're going to look at some of the syntax and the features of the language. I'm going to deliver my very amateur verdict, but it's a verdict nonetheless. And I'm going to provide you all with some resources for further learning if you're interested in pursuing that. Okay, so WTF is Gleam. Well, it's a language for type-safe, scalable systems. So Gleam is statically typed, and it compiles to Erlang. As some of you probably know, static typing is really, really great at finding and preventing bugs before they ever sort of hit production, which we all love. And this is kind of a feature that a lot of Elixir devs are really sad that they're missing out on. Being built on the Erlang virtual machine and adding no additional overhead of its own means that Gleam is super performant and as performant as its counterpart written in Erlang. But it has the luxury bonus of having super friendly syntax. So I would argue Gleam makes happy devs. Not only does it have some really, really great features built in that I'm going to showcase tonight that makes development kind of more joyful, but it's maintained by a really, really awesome community, one of which is here tonight. Hey, Louie. And it's genuinely one of the best code communities I've come across personally. The people are super welcoming and friendly and just happy to jump in and help you out. At the end, I'll share some links so you can get in touch with them, the Discord, and so on. Highly recommend checking it out. You'll come for the language, you'll stay for the people. And my slides are not progressing, that's fun. Okay. Okay, but what is Gleam? Well, a couple of points. There's full typing, as I said previously, speedy compilation, which we all love. There's immutable data structures, which, as Elixir developers, I'm sure we can all appreciate the value of. By default, there's no exceptions and no null or undefined behavior. And I think this is really valuable in that it makes you actually think about the cases where your code is potentially failing and handle them really gracefully. And there's no cost interoperability with Elixir, Erlang, and friends. So as Elixir developers, it's definitely something you should be checking out, especially if you want something that is statically typed, but that has a lot of the benefits of something like Elixir. Also, the color palette absolutely slaps. I'm a big fan. All right, so let's take a look at some of Gleam's syntax. So this is sort of your basic hello world statement in Gleam, just to give you a little taster of what it sort of looks like. We're going to talk about this a bit later on, but you kind of declare functions with this pubfun keyword, and we're just kind of printing hello world to the console. So this is your basic trial sort of function. All of the examples I'm showing tonight are in the documentation, so you can actually go to the docs. They've got really great docs on the Gleam website, which I'll share at the end, and go read more about some of the examples and do a deep dive if you're interested. This is what a basic server looks like in Gleam. So I just wanted to show that off. I know a lot of Elixir developers here are doing stuff with Phoenix and LiveView. So this is kind of a nice comparison for you folks to have a look at. Fairly simple, fairly straightforward, fairly readable. So let's talk about booleans in this language. So Gleam booleans. I didn't realize that was sharing. I'm so sorry.
That's all right.
Cool. All good. Booleans. Gleam booleans are short circuiting, just like Elixir. That is to say, they don't evaluate more than they need to. So if you have a false and a true, it'll only evaluate the false side. This is pretty basic stuff. Something interesting is when written capitalized, they're represented by the atoms true and false at one time. And this is part of how they are directly compatible with Elixir and Erlang booleans. So this is a theme we'll see reoccurring, this sort of really, really low cost interoperability, which I think you folks tonight will get a lot of value out of if you try Gleam. And my slides are, there we go. Integers, yeah, they're integers. They work how you would expect. Something notable, which I really enjoyed back when I was working with Ruby, is we get some niceties like underscores being allowed to be included in your integers just for readability. So that's quite pleasant. All your operators work the same as in Ruby, Elixir, so on. Lots of interesting. They get their own operators, which I think is really neat. I like the explicitness. You know, floats can be hairy at the best of times, so to be explicit about operating on floats specifically to me is valuable because it tunes my brain into thinking that way. They also do get the underscore notation, which I find really helpful for readability, helps your code feel less cluttered. This is in JavaScript. Gleam also has a let keyword. Now, unlike JavaScript, let bindings can be rebound, but the values themselves are immutable. So you can see in this little code snippet I've got up on the screen at the moment, we can rebind x, but then the value of x itself is immutable. Had a great discussion with Yasmin the other day about immutability. So for some of the folks who are newer to coding, immutability is a whole thing. I don't have time to get into it tonight. It's a core concept of Elixir, definitely worth reading up on. You might blow your mind a little bit. Yeah, very confusing stuff. Neat. So expression blocks. All blocks in Gleam are expressions, and every expression in a block is executed, and the result of the last expression is returned. So it's fairly intuitive. One neat feature of this, we can use expression blocks instead of parentheses to change the order of operations. So where you would normally use parentheses around Fahrenheit minus 32 in something like, you know, JavaScript or Elixir, you can actually use expression blocks, which, I mean, this is a relatively simple example, but there's a lot of potential there for some more complex stuff to go on. So lists in Gleam are all homogeneous. So that's to say that like all of the elements in a list must be of the same type, otherwise it throws a type error. And similarly to Elixir, prepending to a list is super, super efficient. It's the preferred way to do things. And also like Elixir, lists are immutable and prepending doesn't mutate that list, it creates a new list. So coming from Elixir, you're gonna be super familiar with how this works. The syntax is a little bit different, but the context is the same. Okay, I'm sorry. I don't like the tuple syntax. It stresses me out. It feels like I'm trying to interpolate something coming from Phoenix and LiveView, that background. But I do like accessor syntax. I like being able to access values with their index. It feels Ruby-ish, I guess. They did have different tuple syntax, which I personally preferred, and that was just tuple bracket values with the word tuple. And I felt like that was really clear and explicit, but they're actually deprecating that, so we're stuck with this. This is my one complaint. This is my moment. I'm sorry, Louis. We're moving on. Case statements. I'm going to go on a little tangent here because case statements are really neat in Gleam. This made me very happy. You can destructure case statements in Gleam. That's really neat. But wait, you can destructure beyond the top level. You can destructure nested levels in your case statements. But then we can also assign names to our nested lists for a line. It reads like a sentence, and that to me just feels good to work with. It's pleasant to work with. It makes me happy. You know, even the folks that sort of aren't familiar with Elixir in the audience tonight, you can kind of tell what's going on here, right? Can I get some nods? Yeah, nice. Thank you. Alternative clauses. This is really interesting to me. So in this little snippet I'm showing on screen now, if the number variable matches any of the values between the pipes, the case will match. I don't know. It's really clean. It doesn't sort of, you know, abstract away a bunch of complex logic. It doesn't take up a lot of lines of code. And I just really like the syntax. It's clean. It's friendly. Something to note, we can use variables here, but all of the variables need to be of the same type. And the same variables need to be declared in all of the patterns that you're sort of matching here. But you can abstract things with variables, which is nice. Okay, so functions, bread and butter. As I mentioned previously, they're declared with the pubfun keywords, like you can see in these little examples here. So Gleam functions are first class values, which means you can pass them to functions, and you can also assign them to variables and everything else you would do with any other data type, really. The compiler type annotations on functions are correct. So this is where typing comes in, something we're missing in Elixir, for those of you who don't have that context. It is being worked on by the core team, but it's kind of like, people have been told not to ask about it. There's a whole thing about that. But yeah, typing. So you can see like in the right tables there is an integer. That's sort of what the type declarations look like in Gleam. Fairly straightforward. Okay, so arguments are a thing in Gleam. We can label our arguments to allow them to be called in a way that reads like a sentence, your code flows like a sentence. And once again, I'm coming back to this theme of developer joy again. It's pleasant to work like this. It's pleasant to write code that reads like a sentence. You can see we've got a function here that replaces some parts of a string. A string pattern replacement in scope here. And you can see when we write a replace function, we can actually say in the string ABC, we can replace each comma with a space, and that'll spit out A space B space C. And isn't that just like so nice to read? It's so friendly to read. If you saw that in a program written by someone else, you would know what it means. So yeah, it really empowers developers to make their code as readable as possible. Last little bit of my rant, I love this. It has a built-in new keyword to indicate work yet to be completed. I especially love this coming from the context of working at a consultancy with teams of developers. Everyone's kind of working on different parts of code. Someone might like know something needs to be implemented and leave a comment. And, you know, it all becomes a bit of a mess over time. It kind of gets forgotten. You end up with tech debt. This is nice because it's a specific keyword put aside for when you want to indicate that a function is yet to be implemented. But in the case of Gleam context, you can still run, you can still like check your code for correct types and compile your code without having to actually write complex logic that might sit inside your code block. And you can also pass the message that gets printed when the function is run. So you see directly where and what, if you write a specific message like this, you do need to implement. So it's just like a really nice, friendly, clear way of telling you, hey, here's a thing that you need to implement. It hasn't been done yet. Your code is hitting this point, And you know, you can't do this with comments. So I really like this. There's a bunch of stuff. I ran out of time to write this talk, and B, didn't want to blow your minds too hard. So there is a bunch more. I know that there is a bunch more. Some reasons, and you can go check out. They have a really, really great like guided language tour on the Docs website. Highly recommend working through that. So the verdict. Once again, this is coming from someone who learned Gleam in a week at a very, very high level. I think Gleam is a pleasant, performant, and full of potential. Ultimately, I think the best use case I can see for Gleam in my professional work is if we use its interoperability with Elixir to harness the power of types. You know, in consulting, I've seen TypeScript become rapidly more and more popular for good reason. Type checking is a really, really powerful tool for stopping bugs that might slip through based on type errors. And if we can kind of grab that power, stick it in with all the niceties that Elixir gives us and the performance, you know, that's a really, really powerful combination. And I'll say, if it's good enough for these three companies here, Discord, Heroku, and WhatsApp, it's definitely good enough for you. So these three companies are using Gleam on their internals, and they're doing really well with it. So if you'd like to learn more about Gleam, if what I've said has piqued your interest, Gleam is the official documentation website, and there's a bunch of other resources linked there that you can check out. I think the team has put together like a repo of awesome Gleam resources, which has like side projects people have done and packages and all sorts of really fun stuff. But official docs are there, including that really, really nice language tour I spoke about, which contains all of the examples I've spoken about in tonight's slides if you want to do a deep dive. And something I found really nice is, among a bunch of other cheat sheets, it's got a cheat sheet specifically for Elixir developers coming into Gleam. So the format of that is basically, here's how you do XYZ in Elixir. This is what it looks like in Gleam. So you've got like a direct comparison to sort of draw on there. The Discord invite link, now I'm pretty sure this is static. If it's not, go to the Docs website. They've got a link to the Discord community on there. Like I said, the community for Gleam is one of the best I have seen throughout, you know, my time as a dev. The people are fantastic. They're super, super helpful. More than happy to help you get started and sort of discuss the language and other random stuff. Go join it. And finally, that's to the languages GitHub repo. There's a bunch of appreciated discussions around the language. There's an example project which I wanted to dive into tonight but ran out of time. They've got like a to-do app that they've built with Gleam. It's a really, really nice sort of introduction to the language in a use case. So yeah, thanks for listening. Questions? I can come over to you with the mic if you like. Yes.
Is there any REPL for it?
Sorry.
REPL.
The REPL itself, that's the Gleam. I can go back to the previous slide.
I can do mic and go for it.
Yeah,
like,
thank you. I would love to. I completely ran out of time this week because I got slammed, but I really want to build, I don't know, just something fun in Gleam, something enjoyable, because I want it to keep sort of in the same tone as the language, and I want to have fun with it because it's just so enjoyable to work in. Maybe a to-do app of my own. I think that's like a good first project, so we'll see.
Questions from in person? Smiths?
Question for the statement. Oh my god, I can't believe
Heroku
is even
Gleam.
Is that, can you
I know.
So weird to hear about.
I know. And Discord. Pretty cool.
Also, I took out the Gleam books too. It is weird, but I appreciate the big pink coloring. Yeah, language is definitely different than, I don't know, like with Elixir, I have the Ruby comparison, but Gleam seems like one step removed. So maybe if I knew, like, is Elixir the bridging gap, do you think, between?
I think, so for context, Yasmin and I went through the docs together initially. I think in your case, coming from Ruby and not necessarily having a functional programming background, I think that's where the kind of knowledge gap exists. Yeah, we're talking about ability, like that kind of concept underpins a lot of the examples in the docs. And that is like a core concept that sort of comes with functional programming, not necessarily always, but a lot of the time. So I think for you personally, Elixir might be the bridging thing between Ruby and Gleam, but for others, maybe not so much, depending on their experience.
Any questions from online people?
I can open the chat. I have.
Feel free to unmute yourself and ask them if you have them.
Everyone was just telling me off about slides by the look of it. So.
Just a question from me. Sorry if you've mentioned it already. Is there any sort of like testing frameworks or like package managers or that sort of thing? Like, what's the sort of tooling like with Gleam?
Yeah, so I'll be honest, I didn't have a lot of time to dive into that because I was in a rush to write this talk. But if you hop over to the Discord or even on the docs, there's like the awesome Gleam resources repo. I think that has a section on tooling and related stuff. Louis, correct me if I'm wrong. You probably know the best place to find this stuff.
Yeah, that's right. For build tooling and package management, it's all built in. You just run Gleam run and Gleam test, and it does it for you. For testing, we've got a test framework that's a wrapper around Erlang's eUnit, but I think in future we may make our own from scratch.
Sweet. Thank you.
Cool. Sounds good.
Anyone else before I saunter off into the background? Going once, going twice. Sweet. Cheers, gang.